This morning, I want to talk with you. I'm going to be basically talking from Numbers chapter 12. But the title that I gave the message today, it just jumped off the page at me. And it comes from Numbers chapter 12. And I have entitled it, The Lord Heard It. The Lord Heard It. We forget that everything we say, the Lord hears everything we are saying. And that you don't find yourself in some corner whispering something and thinking that God is not listening. The Lord hears every single thing. And so today's message to me is amazing. At the same time, it has some things about it that can be a little frightening. I do not have anyone in mind, so I'm not talking about anyone in the service or watching. I'm not talking about any particular person. Of course, I would imagine that many of you think I am talking about you. But if I am, then praise God, this is the time to let's get our lives straight. But to be absolutely honest, I have no person in mind today. Twice in the epistles, Paul told the early church what we will read here in 1 Corinthians 10:11. Now these things happened to them as an example, and they were written for our instruction upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Now that's us. We are the people that the end of the ages has come upon. And there's a part of that that's very exciting. A part of that is, whoa, could that possibly be true? Well, whoa, it is. And he said that what he has written in his word and what he has done is written, it is an example for us. Those that were instructions upon whom the end of the ages have come. Now, you know as well as I do that the word of God presents many stories of many characters throughout the Bible, and they're wonderful stories. We love to read them. And many times they inspire us and with their accomplishments. So this principle that we're talking about here, how God just will present to us stories and tell us everything about what's happening and going on in someone's life, is extremely evident in the lives of three people today that we will look at. And that's Miriam, Aaron, and Moses. Now, you know as good as I do that Miriam was the oldest child. There were three siblings. You know, there was Miriam, Aaron, and Moses. Moses was the youngest. And we meet Miriam for the first time of her baby at the time of her baby brother's birth. And it's a very difficult time in the lives of the children of Israel. They lived in Goshen for more than 350 years. And by the time we come to this story, and what was happening by the time Moses showed up, instead of being protected and instead of them being prospering at that time, they were under the current Pharaoh that they were under, did not know Joseph, is what the scripture says. Didn't know Joseph. And so because they were growing at such an abundant rate, and because the population of the Israelites was exceeding that of the Egyptians, the Pharaoh, who was in charge at that time, he decided, you know, that what he was going to do was, of course, put them in bondage and make slaves out of them, including the parents of Miriam and Aaron and Moses. Now, Israel had changed as a nation. They were blessed and walking with God, and all this stuff. 350 years had gone by. Israel had changed as a nation, and so has the leadership of Egypt. The Israel was so big, and the nation per se that I said that the Pharaoh there was very concerned that he could not control them and they would rise up and turn on the nation of Egypt. So therefore, he put out a law that every boy child would be thrown into the Nile River. In Hebrew, the words beautiful and lovely are not the same thing as you and I interpret it to mean. It simply indicates that the parents knew that something extremely special, or something very special about this boy. And they knew that God had a calling on his life. And when the mother could not hide him, she hid him for 3 months. And when she could hide him no longer, she prepared a basket, and you know, she made it waterproof with pitch, and laid the infant in it, you know the whole story, and put it among the tall grass there on the sides of the riverbanks of the Nile. And in Exodus 2:4, it says that his sister stood at a distance to find out what would happen to him. So we've got big sister looking after little brother here. And so it's estimated that Miriam at this time was between 7 and 8 years old, probably 7 years old at this particular time. But we're impressed with a few things about this 7 year old. She was clearly very attached to her young brother. That's obvious. And even probably terrified of what in the world could happen to him. I mean, you can imagine. And she quickly seized on the opportunity to make sure he was properly cared for by his own mother. Look at God. If we would just be as excited as this mother was, and that she absolutely taught him every single thing about his faith and who he was. And I'm sure even told him about the call of God on his life, just told him everything about it. And how do we know that? Because later, when he was an adult, you know what happened? He chose to return to his own people. And rather than continue to enjoy all the pleasures of Egypt, it says in Hebrews 11. You also must remember, children were not weaned until they were 4 to 5 years old. Now, modern child psychology, they finally caught on, has come to understand that the first 5 years of life are critically important. What children learn and experience during their first 5 years impacts them for the very rest of their lives. And while thousands of newborn baby boys were drowned in the Nile River, thousands, you heard me say thousands, Moses survived against all odds. It took great faith on the part of his parents to come against Pharaoh's orders and hide that infant for 3 months, if you can imagine such. Like them, though, we must never underestimate God's ability to do the impossible. So our first glimpse of Miriam tells us she's intelligent, tells us she's clever, and tells us that she is devoted to her family. Now, we're spending a lot of time on Miriam because this is where we're going. Years later, when the children of Israel crossed the Red Sea on dry ground and the Egyptian army perished in front of all of them, as you remember, Miriam was there, and she led the women in glorious praise and worship. I just find it in Exodus 15, where she's called a prophetess. But something happened to Miriam. I don't know exactly what happened, but I think the Lord has given me a great understanding of it. But you need to understand that things changed. And as you think about that, and I want to repeat that to you, as you think about who she was and that things change, remember, things can change with you. So we will fast forward from seeing that something has happened to Miriam. And we'll go several decades later, many years later, as we still are moving forward here, and turn with me to Numbers chapter 12, and we're going to be amazed at what we see. And by this time, Miriam is probably in her 90s. So anyway, verse 1 of chapter 12. Then Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Cushite woman whom he had married, for he had married a Cushite woman. Here we come to chapter 12, which is just before chapter 13 of Numbers, where the spies go out. So we're right at that place is where we are here. And so immediately we see that Miriam took the lead in criticizing her sister-in-law. But in this situation here, Aaron went along with Miriam's prejudice. What am I talking about? Miriam coming against Moses' wife. So Aaron went along with Miriam's prejudice, and yes, her racism, and Moses' wife was a Cushite, but what it meant, and the problem was, is that she was not a Hebrew. That was the issue. She wasn't part of the Hebrew tribe, for Moses had married a Gentile wife. That was the issue. Look at verse 2 of chapter 12. And they said, "Has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us as well?" That's Aaron and, of course, Miriam saying this. And the Lord heard it. So Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses' wife, but the real issue had much more to do with Moses' leadership than it had to do with his wife. They didn't like the fact that they were not included. You remember, the Lord doesn't come and deal with a group. And so what they did was, Miriam accused Moses of being proud, arrogant, and thinking he was the only one that God spoke through. She was, you know, stirring the wrong pot here. God was paying attention. He had already heard what she had said, just like he's heard what you have said, and he has heard what I have said. He's heard us. Now, church, the root of slander and gossip, which is exactly what was happening here, slander and gossip, is the exaltation of self through the tearing down of somebody else. In other words, you make somebody else, you tear them down and make you look like you're somebody at the expense of someone else's character, or at the expense of just ruining somebody's life. Gossipers will accuse anyone of anything to bring them to nothing, so that the gossiper will feel like they're somebody. Did you hear me?
Yes.
Tearing Moses down and simultaneously lifting themselves up at the same time, that's simultaneously what it means, was a sin of envy. Envy differs from jealousy. Envy wants what somebody else has. Jealousy doesn't want to lose what they already have. I want to keep what I got, and don't you touch it. But envy, I want what you have. I want what you have. Miriam was envious of Moses' position, of his power, and of his influence. Now, Moses had to have been quite a man, since those who knew him best had nothing to accuse him of, except that he married somebody they disapproved of. Now, you know their bad habit, that Miriam and Aaron, they didn't just think of that morning. In other words, they were murmurers before they ever got to this point. Did Moses sense their animosity? The scripture doesn't tell us, but I would venture to say that he did. Moses said absolutely nothing. Well, until much later in the chapter. But it shows amazing restraint to say nothing when you're the target of malicious gossip. It's important to understand that their envious slander of Moses was fueled by a desire to be the one that God chose instead of him. It's ridiculous when you look back at chapter 11 and read how Moses argued with God about his calling. After 40 years in the wilderness, God appeared to him in the burning bush and said, go, and Moses said, no. So how can you say that he put himself there? He didn't. Do you notice that nowhere in the text does it say that Moses heard their gossip and slander? You know why? Because they didn't say it to Moses. They said it about Moses. A gossiper will never go to the person. They talk to others about the person. That's what gossipers do.
The fate of America is in the hands of the church. Will we wake up and rise to the occasion? A Pocket of Time is an end-time 3-CD series supernaturally given to Sandra as a word for today. These teachings will help you know how to pray, how to take your stand, and will open your eyes to what's happening in America and around the world. The day is short and the opportunity is fading, so order A Pocket of Time by calling or by going to our website.
Miriam and Aaron ran their mouths, tearing down Moses. And the Lord heard it. The Lord heard it. And so, in face of what the Lord had heard it, then the Lord himself came to Moses' defense. Wow, look at verse 3. Now the man Moses was very humble, more than any man who was on the face of the earth. Now we know that Moses wrote the Torah. Is it reasonable to think that Moses put that in there about himself? Every Bible you've ever seen has that particular part in parentheses. And universally, Bible scholars agree that this verse was added in after Moses had written the Torah. Why did the Holy Spirit allow this verse to be added? Because the principle to be learned from it was, and still is, so critical to Israel and to the church. Verse 4. Suddenly the Lord said to Moses and Aaron and to Miriam, you three come out to the tent of meeting. So the three of them came out. I hope you're getting this. The Lord spoke to all three of them. I'm ready to meet with y'all. I heard what you said. I would like to meet with you. You have to understand, one has to wonder if they were so full of themselves that they actually thought God was going to straighten Moses out. After all, pride makes people think differently. How do you know what pride looks like? Well, hello, church. Can't you hear Miriam thinking, kid brother's about to get what he deserves. God's shown up and could take him down a peg or two. That's what pride thinks, church. Why did God deal with Miriam and Aaron this way? Because he hates pride for what it does to his people. Proverbs 6, 16 through 19. There are six things which the Lord hates, yea, seven, which are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that run rapidly to evil, a false witness who utter lies, and one who spreads strife among the brethren. The sinner hates the sin, because the damage it does to his children, and sometimes the damage is so severe that it just absolutely tears people up. Churches who tolerate gossip, slander, and strife are torn apart and do great damage to the souls of the congregation. The suddenness of God's intervention in this passage should get our undivided attention. It's a very serious reaction that God instantly reacted to. It was a righteous anger that God displayed in response to what Miriam had done and Aaron's behavior, and pronounced judgment on Miriam swiftly. Do you understand why God takes this so seriously? Because it happened to him. I said it happened to him. Heaven went through a church split when Lucifer rebelled and heaven would never be the same again. Listen to me, church. The Bible tells us. That's why there's a new heaven and a new earth. There will be a new heaven. There will be a new earth. And Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words won't pass away. So the earth we know is going to be gone. And the heaven as it is now, as magnificent as it is, will not stay the same. It will pass away. Now, it was a worship leader of heaven that rebelled. Lucifer was a worship leader of heaven. Pride. When people get more performance oriented than worship oriented, where you get caught up in your performance rather than in worshiping the Lord, where we try to make ourselves so professional and show off who we really are. Pride. God hates it. Hates pride. At the root of all of it, self-centeredness. Forgetting that the scriptures tell us that your gift will make room for you. You don't have to push it on somebody. Look at verses 5 through 8. Then the Lord came down in a pillar of cloud and stood at the doorway of the tent, and he called Aaron and Miriam. When they had both come forward, he said, "Now hear my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, shall make myself known to him in a vision. I shall speak with him in a dream. Not so with my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my household. With him I speak mouth to mouth, even openly and not in dark sayings. And he beholds the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant, against Moses?" Now they're shaking in their sandals, I'm sure. It's clear that God is not about to do what they wanted him to do. It's not Moses who's in trouble. They are. God defended Moses in no uncertain terms because their accusations were false. Moses was blameless, and let me state this, Moses had murdered somebody. God knows the journey he's taken Moses through. The first 40 years of his life, he was a somebody, prince of Egypt. The next 40 years of his life, he was a nobody, an obscure shepherd in Midian. The last 40 years of his life, God could use him mightily, because he'd been humbled, he'd been broken, and he'd been reluctant to embrace his calling. It's the reluctant servant that God chooses, not the one saying, "Pick me, pick me, pick me, here I am." Moses had proved himself faithful. He didn't do most of what God told him to do. He did everything God told him to do. Church, there really is no defense against false accusations. One of the great lessons of life and of this chapter in the Bible is to learn to let God defend you in his time and in his way. He'll do it too. He'll do it. Verses 9 through 10. So the anger of the Lord burned against them and he departed. But when the cloud had withdrawn from over the tent, behold, Miriam was leprous, as white as snow. As Aaron turned toward Miriam, behold, she was leprous. Leprosy is a hideous disease. It eats away one's flesh and attacks the nerve endings. It's a death sentence. In this case, it was a death sentence because of the gossip and the slander. That's why it was a death sentence. Gossip and slander put her here. She was struck with an advanced stage of leprosy. That's what it means when you say the white as snow. Those who have turned whiter at death's door. Yes, it was a harsh judgment. Because when Miriam falsely accused Moses, She was accusing, falsely accusing God. For all intents and purposes, church, she was saying, God, you made a terrible mistake. You should have made me the leader. God's reply was, you deserve to die for this, Miriam. Over and out. Be thankful you and I live under the age of grace. Church, listen. Wanting to be exalted to a position that's been given by God to someone else puts you in the company of Lucifer, who said, I will exalt myself above the throne of God. Many church splits are caused because of that paragraph. Why only Miriam? Why not Aaron? Because Miriam was the ringleader. Because Aaron was the high priest. And if he was struck with leprosy, let me ask you, my friend, who's going to intercede? Israel would have been left without a priest to intercede for them if Aaron had been taken down. Verses 11 through 12. Then Aaron said to Moses, O my Lord, I beg you, do not account this sin to us in which we have acted foolishly and in which we have sinned. Oh, do not let her be like one dead whose flesh is half eaten away when he comes from his mother's womb. I'm going to tack this last little part of the scripture in here because I want you to understand what really happened. Numbers 12, 13 through 15. Moses cried out to the Lord saying, Oh God, heal her, I pray. But the Lord said to Moses, If her father had but spit in her face, would she not bear her shame for 7 days? Let her be shut up for 7 days outside the camp, and after she may be received again. So Miriam was shut up outside the camp for 7 days, and the entire congregation, they did not move until Miriam was received again. Her sin affected the entire nation of Israel. So let me close with this. Jesus said, what you do to the least of these, you do it unto me when you slander and gossip. And slander and gossip have no place in the body of Christ. I know no greater way to make that clear than this passage of scripture that we've used today. May the Holy Spirit draw us more and more into the mind of Christ so that gossip and slander will never find a home in our minds or cross our lips in Jesus' name. I don't know about you, but I want to be pleasing in the sight of God. Amen. And all I can say is that God is a forgiving God. And we just have to, you know, Lord, forgive us. Forgive us. Forgive us.